back when I was a child, before life removed all the innocence, my father would lift me high and dance with my mother and me, and then spin me around till I fell asleep. Then up the stairs he would carry me, and I knew for sure I was loved. If I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him, how I'd love, love, love to dance with my father again. Ooh. When I and my mother would disagree, to get my way I would run from her to him. He'd make me laugh just to comfort me, yeah, yeah. Then finally make me do just what my mama said. Later that night when I was asleep, he left the dollar under my sheet. Never dreamed that he would be gone from me. If I could steal one final glance, one final step, one final dance with him, I'd play a song that would never, ever end. 'Cause I'd love, love, love to dance with my father again. Sometimes I'd listen outside her door, and I'd hear how my mother cried for him. I'd pray for her even more than me. I'd pray for her even more than me. I know I'm praying for much too much, but could you send back the only man she loved? I know you don't do it usually, but dear Lord, she's dying to dance with my father again. Every night I fall asleep, and this is all I ever dream. Friends,
we have gathered here today to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of the Honorable Charles E. Baglan, Jr. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. But in the midst of our grief, there is great joy, for it was Charlie's Lord who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." We come together in grief, and yet God has granted us joy. We continue to grant us comfort when we experience pain, to help us to have hope when we experience sorrow, and when we too meet death, to give us resurrection. Let us pray. O God, you gave us birth to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask, and you know our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Charlie was a great lover of the outdoors. Whether it was riding his horse or working his dogs, fishing, or perhaps even skiing, he loved God's creation. I think he could appreciate very much the idea that his Lord was a good shepherd. So let us hear the beautiful, loved, beloved words of the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. With the death of Charlie, many of us lost a dear, good friend. But Jesus understands our grief, for he too lost a good friend. Let us hear the account from the Gospel of John when Jesus lost his friend Lazarus, and understand that as we grieve, he grieves along with us. Chapter of John's Gospel, we read these words. When Jesus arrived in Bethany, he found that his friend Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said, I know that he will rise in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet. And when Jesus saw her weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. Where have you laid him? He asked. They said to him, Lord, come and see. And Jesus began to weep. And so the Jews said, see how he loved them? And Jesus cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And the dead man came out, and his hands and his feet were bound with strips of cloth, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In the last week before Charlie passed away, he sent a good friend a prayer that he had found on the internet. They had been corresponding back and forth by means of text message. And he wanted her to get a prayer that meant a great deal to him, that gave him the confidence for the future. And I think this prayer is appropriate for us as well. I'd like to share it with you at this time. Heavenly Father, I may not understand how everything will work out, but I trust you. I don't see a way, but I know that you will make a way. I have faith that at this very moment you are touching hearts, opening doors, and lining up the right breaks and the right opportunities. Things may look dark and bleak now, but I have faith that my dawn is coming. In Jesus' name, amen.
For all the times you stood by me, for all the truth that you made me see, for all the joy you brought to my life, for all the wrong that you made right, for every dream you made go through, for all the love I found in you, I'll be forever thankful, baby. You're the one who saw.
This afternoon, we're glad to invite Michael Darby to come and give a witness to the life of Judge Charlie Baglan. He's been his friend for 16 years and his law partner, so we look forward to what he has to share.
Thank you, family. Thank you for allowing me the honor to talk on behalf of Charlie. I didn't make it very far, did I? My day is going back to Charlie date back 2005. I practiced law in South Mississippi for a grand total of 2 months. I hated it, and I come back and I was farming. My daddy was really upset with me, to say the least. But I got a call from Cindy in our office. Her family and my family go way back. I said, come on up here and meet and talk with Charlie. And so I did. I went up there, and I guess this was probably late February of 2005. And I met with him. And I found out later he had interviewed other folks. But the interview, I thought it went pretty well. And then at the end, he's like, okay, when can you start? I said, well, I guess it did go really well then. And he asked me, he says, well, how much do you need to start? And I told him. He said, okay. I'll tell you later on, I did learn a lesson from him on that. He said, Michael, we hit it off on that interview so well. It was so good, but you made one mistake. I said, what's that, boss? He said, you didn't ask for enough money. And I said, well, would you have given it to me? He said, no. But you didn't ask. And so I learned then, you got to ask. And I really learned the type of person. I didn't know Charlie at that time. I knew of him because he's from here and we're from here. But I learned what kind of person he was a week later. I've been working for Charlie less than a week when my grandmother passed away. And Charlie was the first one there. Charlie was the first one reaching out. Charlie was the first one sending things. And then and there I knew what kind of man Charlie Baglan was. And so I go back to work, and I'm working. I've been there a few months at this point, and I'd sit in on one trial with Charlie. We do mostly workers' comp work, as some of you may know. And he said, well, we got a trial in South Mississippi coming up next week. I want you to prepare for this part, and I'll prepare for this part, but just look at everything a little bit. And I said, okay. So we meet at the office, and Charlie at that point had just got a brand-new convertible Corvette. He loved that car. It was a nice car. I liked it, too. But we start going. He picks me up, and we're heading to South Mississippi. I don't know if many of y'all make the trip down Interstate 55, but there used to be an old truck stop somewhere around Lexington. We had talked about the case up to that point, and he looks at me and says, man, I don't feel good. Pull over to this truck stop. And I said, okay. So we stop at that truck stop, and then he says, I'm just not going to be able to do this. Well, you want me to call the judge and cancel hearing? Oh, no, you're good. You're good. I'll call Jeannie. She'll come pick me up. So Jeannie came and picked him up, and he sent me down to try my first case all by myself. And I get down there, and the lawyer doesn't know me, but she knows Charlie. The judge don't really know me, but he knows Charlie. And they let me start to try the case, and about halfway through, the judge looked at the defense attorney. Don't you want to do something? And so she said, yeah. They took me out, and we settled the case. By the way, I was getting to drive Charlie's brand-new Corvette, too, so that was a nice little byproduct. And so I get back, and he doesn't tell me that day, but later on he told me. I looked at him. I said, were you really sick? And he says, oh, man, no. He says, I just didn't want you to have time to get nervous. And so after that, I've never had a hearing where I ever got nervous but that's because of Charlie. He knew how to make me handle that. That was his way of doing that, and I'm always appreciative of that. And after that, he turned me loose in the firm and let me do basically on my own. And me and him at that point, that's where our relationship really, really started to blossom. We got to be really good friends. We talked every day for at least an hour. I mean, either I'm in his office first thing in the morning bugging him with some crazy question, or we're doing lunch. And we do lunch every day, almost. And at those lunches, you know, or that morning, we talked about everything. Bird dogs. Boy, he could talk about bird dogs. To this day, I can't tell you the difference between one and another, but he loved talking about bird dogs and his horses. He went through cycles about camping, whether he liked it or he didn't. Fishing. He loved motorcycles before his first stroke. He really liked those. And we talked a lot about our clients. He really loved our clients. He told me, Michael, we represent working folks. Our job is to watch out for those people because the law's not going to. And we did. And he instilled a strong personality in both me and Larry. Granted, my voice is not as strong as Charlie's. Anybody that knows Charlie knows he could cut this off and you could hear him from a mile away. Strong voice. But he installed that in us. But the thing we talked about the most when me and him were together was family. We had, in mine and his mind, maybe we're the only one, we had three types of family, three different branches. We had our office family. And when I say family, he meant it. It was family to him. Y'all were family to him. He loved us. He was always there for us, the good times and the bad. Each person over there can tell you a personal story of how Charlie Baglan was there for him. Good time, bad time, he was there. You know, I've got my own personal stories, good time, bad time, and I could sit here for hours on hours on going through those. But when my dad passed away 4 years ago, the first person that was there was Charlie Baglan. The first person that called was Charlie Baglan. First person in my house was Charlie Baglan. Charlie, at that point, me and him were really close, but he became a second father to me at that point. And he was always there. I kidded around with him. I said, before Daddy would pass, I said I'd call Daddy and ask him something. And he'd tell me to do something. I said, did I ask you the same question? And you'd give me the same answer. I said, did my dad call you before I asked? And he would always tell me, no, no. And I said, well, both of y'all are very, very smart men, and I trust your opinions. They're in the good times. You know, as many of you may know, I'm fairly old. I'm in my mid-40s, and I decided I'm going to have me a little one. And I couldn't trade anything in the world for that little one. He's the joy of my life. But I think he was the joy of Charlie's life, too. He talked about him all the time. And so we have our first, his one-year-old birthday party in June of 2019. And Charlie's politicking at that point. He's out in the heat, and this had to be the hottest day of the year. And him and Mary Catherine, they finished their politicking, I guess, that morning. And here they come. We're having an outside birthday party. And I know Charlie's got to be burning up. I'm like, man, go inside. Thank you for coming. But nope, that's Collins' birthday party. And he brought, by the way, they brought a tractor. And he finally broke that tractor, Mary Catherine. It took him a while, but he got it. But he was there for the good times. He was there for the good times for any of us and all of us. But that was the office family. Then he had his real family, his blood family. I shouldn't say real family. We were his real family, too. But he had his brothers and his brother and sisters. He talked a lot about y'all. A lot. He had become really sad over y'all's family have been, really been through it here recently. with the loss of Mary Eunice, Rita, Pat, and Jean, and now Charlie, but they're all up there celebrating together. You know, George, Lynn, Lottie, and Debbie, he thought the world of y'all. Some of the last conversations I had was with him talking about you, George, you know, how he wanted you to get well. And I think you shared this, the same version with me as what Charlie told me before, and that, you know, he was really happy you had beat this, okay? But Charlie had been diagnosed with cancer, and he knew he had it, and he knew he had to go through these chemo treatments. And so he loaded up to go see George. And George was telling him about these chemo treatments, how the first ones were a breeze. But I think George got in to tell him the last one's not so much. And Charlie said, man, I told George, just hush. I don't want to hear about it. If it hits me, it hits me. But let's don't talk about it. But family, he loved y'all. He loved y'all, and he talked about y'all a lot. And then there's y'all. My family. Chase, Anna, Mary Catherine, y'all were the loves of his life. Every day, not every other day, every day, we talked about one, two, or all three of you. It's just the way it was. You know, Chase, I remember you as a little fella, and I bought a house in 2006. And, you know, I was figuring out who's going to cut my grass, because I wasn't cutting it. And Chase was cutting the grass at the shop, and so he started cutting the grass. His mama would bring him over there, unload him with the trailer, and Chase would go at it. I saw right then the work ethic you had. Me and your dad talked about that a lot. You know, when his time went on and you moved on and you started other things, my wife there, she opens up a business. Something tears, I can't change a light bulb, folks, okay? But something tears up, my wife would always say, call Chase. Call Chase. Chase knows how to do it. Chase, he was so proud of you. He was proud of the young man you were and the man you've become. He'll always be proud of you, and he loved you dearly. And then Anna. Boy, when I met Anna, she was knee-high to a grasshopper. And she'd come up to that office. And sassy little thing. I don't know if she's changed much, but she was sassy back then. And we loved her, though. And over time, she kept coming. And finally, she started working at the office. And when she did, I found out something Charlie had been telling me for years. That girl's smart. She's one of the smartest people I've ever met. But you were also Charlie's baby girl, and he talked about you in that light all the time. He loved you dearly. He was so proud of what you had done and accomplished. And as an engineer, and Charlie was proud. He was proud you were getting to go and see and do. That's what he wanted for you. He loved you dearly. He was proud of the young lady you were and the young woman you've become. He loved you more than you'll ever know. And then, Mary Catherine, what do you say? You were the love of his life. We talked about that. Charlie's not the most emotional person, as many of you know. He probably would get me for shedding a tear right now and say, no, but he loved you. You would call, and I would be sitting with him, and we'd be at lunch or something, and you would call, and every time he'd get off the phone with you, for y'all that didn't know, Charlie had the best grin on the planet. He would grin and say, I couldn't make it without her, and he would always do that. You were the light of his life. You have always been the light of his life, and he's looking down on heaven from you now. When Charlie was in the hospital, in the ICU, I was with him, I guess, the second or third day. Mary Catherine's had some sickness issues, and as soon as I walked up to him, you know, Charlie in and out of sleeping, and as soon as he wakes up, how's Mary Catherine? Is Mary Catherine okay? Michael, you make sure, take care of Mary Catherine. Make sure. I promised him, you will always be okay. Family, you will always be okay. You have one wonderful person in each of your lives. You had one wonderful person in each of your lives. Everybody here that knew Charlie, you had a wonderful person in your life. Charlie leaves a lasting legacy. You two are his testament. As long as you two are around, you look in the mirror, Charlie will always be here. You look at each other, Charlie will always be here. He is unusual to have the type of legacy that he has with family, and that's unique. Charlie, that wasn't Charlie's only legacy. Charlie was beloved. I'm sure there's people in here that were clients of Charlie. When I say his clients beloved him, he was beloved by his clients. They knew Charlie was going to fight for him to the end, and he would stand by them no matter what. Having that is a legacy that not many have. Charlie has. People here, you're here because you either knew Charlie, you liked Charlie, you loved Charlie, you respected Charlie. You are part of his legacy. He will always be with us. Charlie Baglan was initially my boss. Charlie Baglan then became my friend. Charlie Baglan will always be my family. I love him. I love y'all. I love y'all. God bless.
Thank you, Michael. Family, hear the words of comfort that God has for you. This is from the book of 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. Now, I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? What kind of body do they come? For what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. And when this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And may God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Amen. Friends, there's no other way to address this except that this moment is always an humbling moment. When faced with death, we're also faced with our own mortality. When we're faced with our own mortality, we start thinking about how we're going to number our days, how we're going to know what is important, how we'll spend the moments that make up our lives. And, of course, when we stand in the presence of death, we also feel some disorientation in our life as well, because we're faced with the uncertainty of what life will be like without a husband, without a father, without a brother, without a friend present with us. There are just a lot of unknowns before you. Death itself is mysterious to us, because while we proclaim many things through faith concerning just exactly what death is, we don't have any knowledge of death other than what we say through faith. Because what we know is life. I'm Kerry Powell. I've been the pastor here at Batesville for just a little over a year, and I didn't really get to know Judge Baglan. I didn't get Mr. Charlie, I don't know how to, I'm going to call him Judge. How about that? I didn't really get to know him. I wish I had before all of this stuff happened, because he had a wonderful attitude toward life. I kind of read through some things, talked to the family a little bit. I've started Googling him, and I came across this article about a judge and a bird dog. I thought, this must be him. This must be him. But it wasn't. It was about a case back in the late 1800s where there was a dog that was a wonderful hunting dog. His name was Drum. And somebody had shot the dog and got sued. And the lawyer in the case made this wonderful plea. He simply said this. Gentlemen of jury, a man's dog stands by him in prosperity, in poverty, in health, and in sickness. He'll sleep on the cold ground where the wintry winds blow and the snow drives fiercely if he can be near his master's side. Anyway, he went on and finally got to the point where the jury just said, well, we're gonna give that man money for his dog. Gave him about three times as much. Anyway, I thought that would be great for him to have to hear in his court. I thought he might enjoy something like that, but it wasn't him. He loves nature, I was told. I just decided I'd get off Google and start calling people and asking about Judge Baglan. Round and round, he was loved for his dependability, for his knowledge. He was loved for his drive to do what is right in this world. Without fail, he was admired as a person who was considerate, who enjoyed being around other people. I got told a time or two about his motorcycles, and that he really liked them, and that he also liked high-powered vehicles to have around. And the more all of this kind of fell into place, I realized that today, even though it's really easy to do, we're not talking about death. We're talking about life. And how we live that life is of course important. Of course he loved the outdoors. Of course he loved motorcycles. Of course he loved a good, powerful vehicle. Of course he liked a good meal. And judging from the slideshow, he liked to dress pretty snappy every now and then, too. Of course that. Of course he loved your family, by his provision, by his encouragement, by his teaching, by the opportunities he's given you to excel, to love and to be loved. Of course he loved his family. And he loved his work family. He loved his friends. All of those things, what we're talking about is life. And it's life that's well lived. And ultimately for Judge Baglan, this became a way to launch out into the world and to make a difference for the sake of everyone. He loved life, and he expressed that by engaging people, by fellowshipping with others, by helping friends, and those who crossed his path any way that he could. And there's no doubt that we will miss him, that you will miss him. Family, today I encourage you to just look around this sanctuary, to know that these people are here because they respected Judge Baglan and loved Judge Baglan, but they're here because they love you too. And in the days that are ahead of you, when you're just missing him, these are the people who will hear you. These are the people who will share life with you. And friends, I encourage you to see this family and to know that as Christian brothers and sisters in the days ahead, when he crosses your mind because of something funny that happened, because of a way you were strengthened or a way that he walked with you, take the moment to sit down and pick up a phone, to write a note, and just say, I remember that time. That's what we do. We bear one another's burdens, and we walk with one another through life. When we see somebody like Judge Baglan, who loved everyone, who loved this community, it feels like our loss is magnified. That's not anything uncommon. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, question. And in this particular section, what they thought about death. And Paul took this opportunity to remind them that for Christians, it is essential that we remember that the foundational thing is based in this resurrection power of Jesus Christ. God puts us together, body and soul, as his followers. God gives a body as he has chosen, Paul writes. What's sown is perishable, what's raised is imperishable. It's sown in dishonor, it's raised in glory. It's sown in weakness, but it's raised in power. It's sown a physical body, but it's raised a spiritual body. And in times of sorrow and grief, Paul says it's necessary for the people of God to turn their attention to life, specifically eternal life. Jesus understands this. Even when the disciples were up in arms about Jesus' pending death, Jesus took them aside and he spoke to them. And listen to what he said. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and I prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. It's a human experience to consider the effect of life and death on all of us, but what we're told is when we think about Jesus Christ, when we remember all the experiences of shared life together, all the teachings, all the healing words and touches, all the adventures, all the laughter, it's in remembering that we're able to look forward in Christ to a different way of experiencing life altogether, especially when we know that Jesus Christ has conquered death. There's no doubt, again, that this community, that you, that we will miss Judge Baglan. But we can celebrate that his life, his life's work with the dispirited and the dispossessed, his life of faithfully walking with people through difficult times and celebrating wondrous time gives testament to this Christ that we serve, who would never forsake us or leave us. That's a good promise. Sometimes we really try to separate our our vocations from what God's calling us to do. And in my mind, Judge Baglan found the perfect set. He gave himself heart, soul, mind, and body to do the work God had called him to do. And again, Jesus knows. In Matthew chapter 11, Jesus himself said, "Come to me, all you who labor, and I'll give you rest." And in this day, we have the assurance that Christians through the ages have possessed, that the sum of our entire lives, the sum of our being is remembered by God. We are blessed with his salvation through eternal life. And even now, in the midst of death, we can celebrate a life well lived, a love that was well placed, and a hope that will surely bear fruit in all the days to come. Amen. Amen.
I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice. Thank you.
God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you're still God. We pray to you for one another in our time of need and for all everywhere who mourn with us today. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To those who have sinned, mercy. And to all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you and to your church on earth and in heaven. We offer honor and glory forever and ever. Lord, all that you have given us is yours. And as you gave Charlie Baglan to us first, we now give him back to you. Receive him into the arms of your mercy. Raise him up with all your people, and receive us also, and raise us up into new life, and help us to so love and to serve you in this world that we may enter with joy into the world to come. Let's pray. God of love, we thank you for all that you blessed us with, even to this day, for the gift of joy in days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in the days of grief and pain. We praise you for home and friends and for our baptism and our place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us now and forevermore. Amen. And now, friends, may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you will never not do his will, and that you'll work what's pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen.
God bless you all. I love you. Let me know if you need anything.